Okay, so we're going to take these phasors and subtract phase A current with phase C current, and then look at what our line current A looks like, right? So here's phase A current, and here is phase C current. Now, if we were to perform phase A current plus phase C current, we would do this through what we call a head-to-tail method. And how that works is very simple. We pick up phase C current and add it to the head of phase A current. And the resultant vector starts from the origin and goes towards the head of phase C current. So this right here is our resultant vector. And this resultant vector equals phase A current plus phase C current. However, this is not what we want. What we want to equate is this equation, phase A current minus phase C current. So let's clean this up a little bit and put phase C current back to where it was. Okay, now because there's a minus sign that's associated with phase C current, we have to pick up phase C current and rotate it 180 degrees. So phase C current becomes like this. So this phasor here is negative phase C current. And now let's pick this up again and connect it to the head of phase A current. So now we're gonna connect it like that, okay? Now the resultant vector starts from the origin and ends at the head of negative phase C current. Now notice that the resultant vector is a lot longer now, right? And the resultant vector represents phase A current minus phase C current. Now believe it or not, this phasor diagram actually represents this particular equation, right? And this resultant vector is actually representing this line current here. So what we're saying when comparing line current with phase current A, now remember this is phase current A here and this is line current A here, so let's label that a little better. We see that the line current is a lot larger than our phase current, right? So this is our phase current here and this is our line current. So the magnitude of our line current, which starts from the origin and ends at this tip here, that is a lot larger than our phase current. In fact, if we compare the two, we will find that the line current is actually the square root of 3 times larger than our phase current. So if we take our phase current here and line it up with our line current, we'll be at this point here. But then we would have to stretch it, or we would have to multiply it by the square root of 3, or 1.73, to make it equal our line current. So that's the first observation, that our line current is a square root of 3 times larger than our phase current, okay? Now, also notice that our line current has a phase shift that's associated with it, right? So if these were all, if all the phasors were rotating in a counterclockwise direction, which they should according to international standards, they were all rotating in a counterclockwise direction, we will see that the line current has a 30 degrees phase shift, okay? So this 30 degree, so number two, line current has a 30 degrees phase shift with respect to phase current. Before we conclude here, when I was first learning this, this particular phasor analysis was very complicated. It didn't sit with me very well. So let's take a step back and then walk through this step by step, okay? So what we're actually doing with this phasor analysis is we're trying to compute this particular equation. And what we're saying is if we subtract phase current A minus phase current C, we'll get line current A. And this is exactly what we did. We took phase current A and we subtracted phase current C, and what we got right here is line current A, okay? And all we're saying is if we compare phase current A, which is this phasor here, with this line current A, which is this phasor here, we'll see that the line current is a lot larger than our phase current, okay? Not only is it larger, but it also has a 30 degrees phase shift. This line current has a 30 degrees phase shift. So going back to our diagram, what we're saying is that this line current here, if we compare this line current with this phase current, which is the phase current that's flowing through the primary phase A winding, this line current is going to be square root of 3 times larger than this phase current. And this line current is also going to have a 30 degrees phase shift with this phase A current, okay? So let's take another step back and ask ourselves, why is our line current different from our phase current? is because when we set our phase A, B, and C currents, we said that we would have a balanced system. And in this balanced system, we have 120 degrees phase shift between our three phasors, all right? So phase A is 120 degrees apart from phase B, and phase B is 120 degrees apart from phase C. Now, because we have a balanced system, and because the phase currents are 120 degrees apart, when we're subtracting one phase current with another phase current, the angles is the magic that gets you the square root of 3 times larger and the 30 degrees phase shift. So it's the angle of phase A current, which is at 0 degrees, right, which we define here, and the angle of phase C current, which is at 120 degrees, which we define here. That's what's causing the square root of 3 times difference and a 30 degrees phase shift between the phase current and the line current. Thank you. If you like this video, please consider subscribing. This video was brought to you by GeneralPAC.com, making power system protection, automation, and controls intuitive.